But first, we must discuss Henry Bolton. Sacked finally as UKIP leader, and what a shambles it has been. We actually had a situation yesterday, I couldn't believe it, where Henry Bolton was comparing the intrusion into his personal life to that suffered by Princess Diana. Yeah, I can think of a few differences, including the substances of people's anger. I mean, Bolton left his wife for a girlfriend, Jo Marnie, who was sending racist texts about Meghan Markle. Pretty low stuff. Saying that Prince Harry's black American fiancé would taint the royal family with her seed. What a disgrace. It was embarrassing. And even last week, Henry Bolton was still talking about his love for her. That after mass resignations in his party that he decided to totally ignore. I mean, just embarrassing. And it's not like it's been the first debacle for UKIP. I mean, Paul Nuttall, remember him? I mean, he was leader less than a year ago. He had to resign after losing to Labour in Stoke and then coming third in Boston and Skegness in 2017. That was supposed to be the Brexit capital of the country. And don't forget the leadership contest that followed. Remember Stephen Wolfe? I mean, he was, you know, reasonably impressive. I didn't agree with him, I'll be honest. But, you know, he was out because he submitted his papers late. Then Diane James got elected and resigned within about 3 minutes. Then we got Henry Bolton, who's no one's ever heard of. I actually think one of the most interesting things about Boris Johnson's speech last week, which was about Brexit and the Liberal case, was that he argued the Brexit vote had effectively killed off UKIP, while far-right parties were thriving in other parts of Europe. And I thought that was really interesting. But it isn't just Brexit that has rot this party. It is really mismanagement and incompetence and embarrassment. And, you know, I really can't see what UKIP can do now to get back up off its knees, even though actually there is an opportunity here for UKIP, because, you know, people might feel betrayed by Brexit by this time next year. Maybe Nigel Farage was Brexit, was UKIP, sorry, and that's the only way that they're going to get back up again if he comes back. Well, I'm sure people will have lots to say on that. We're also talking about the ECJ and whether it's really necessary as a red line. And I'd just like to go to Thomas in Worthing, because Thomas, I see that you're also a former UKIP member.
It's good timing. I resigned 3 weeks ago, funnily enough.
Oh, was it because of Henry Bolton?
Well, I think that was probably the cherry on the top of the cake, as it were. I mean, the party's been an absolute shambles for, you know, easily since the referendum result, probably before that, actually, when Nigel Farage resigned as leader. And I wasn't a particularly huge fan of Nigel Farage, even, to be honest.
What, have you become a Tory now?
Oh, God, no. Hell no. No.
where did you go? So from UKIP to
Independent.
Oh, okay.
I'm not going to be, no, I just, none of the parties actually answer any of the problems that I pose. I mean, I'm a disabled person, so I couldn't join the Conservatives. I'm certainly not going to be supporting UKIP in the future. I'm very uncomfortable by the anti-Semitism in the Labour Party at the moment. And the Liberal Democrats obviously aren't listening to the Brexit voters, so I have nobody to vote for.
None of the above. The logical...
Yeah, exactly. And this is a big problem in politics at the moment. But yeah, anyway, back to the...
Yeah, back to the subject. So just tell me, why did you vote for Brexit?
For a whole manner of reasons. I'm concerned about the overdevelopment of the Greenbelt in this country, and that obviously works hand in hand with, you know, mass transit of people and massive overdevelopment. I live on the south coast, and I mean, all of the green areas I used to play in as a child have been developed. You've got issues surrounding jurisdiction, you've got issues surrounding, ironically, the European arrest warrant. This is one of one of the things that was actually talked about in UKIP circles in particular before the referendum.
So you're actually worried about some of the security cooperation that we have?
I'm worried that people seem to be being extradited to countries with no real tangible evidence for prolonged stays in prisons, and this can obviously have an impact on people's lives. I mean, the funny thing is, I mean, when UKIP were going around the country with meetings with Nigel Farage and others, before the referendum, they had this video that they played everybody before the main speaking portion play, interviewing people who had been subject to European arrest falsely. There are numerous examples online you can look up, the likes of Tracy Malompe, who was arrested and extradited to Portugal, subjected to strip search by Portuguese authorities because of something her ex-husband had done 12 years previous. You've got a student from the University of Brighton, at the age of 20, a guy called Ben Herdman, who was extradited to Greece with some friends of his because of something was that he was falsely accused of in a nightclub outside, in Crete in 2010. I mean, there are
So you frankly think that the security cooperation we're talking about isn't really about trying to reduce terrorism?
Oh, no, I have absolutely no doubt whatsoever that, you know, there is room there to cooperate with the European Union and Europe with regards to things like terrorism. We have, you know, obviously MI5 and other organisations in this country that work to try and stop these things from happening. And I'd like to think that, you know, regardless of whether we're in the EU or the European Court of Justice, we would still cooperate with our European partners to make sure that people are safe in Europe and in the United Kingdom. And I'd like to think that European Union and, you know, the Europe as a whole would cooperate with our services as well if they found out anything that could pose a threat to people in this country as well.
And just finally on that, in order to secure that, would you accept maintaining the jurisdiction of the ECJ in this one precise area?
Well, this is one of the problems from the referendum that I don't think people were actually made aware of what being part of the European Court of Justice actually entails, what it rewards us with, and also some of the negatives. It would be nice if, you know, it was outlined in detail what exactly being part of that organisation entails. I mean, once that actually happens, and you're right, you're absolutely right from the beginning, people don't know, you know, the negatives and the positives about being part of this organisation. If people did, then they would be able to make more informed decisions.
OK, thank you, Thomas. Some very interesting, different perspectives there about our security cooperation. And I see we've got very, very different views on it coming in.